we'll go to the next topic, which is line widths. We have always said transition will occur when the energy matches the energy levels. So there has to be a very short frequency then. Right? At only one frequency, a transition should happen. But you will always see that every line in your spectrum, no matter where you are talking about optical spectroscopes, there are various reasons, you always have a line width. Why is the line width? How does this come about? Okay. So the answer to this lies, once again, in quantum mechanics, and that is the uncertainty principle. This is defined in various different ways depending upon the observables you choose. In this case, we choose energy and time. We can also do with momentum and x coordinates. We choose here energy and time. This is equal to h. If there is any uncertainty in the energy, so that means there is a certain width for the energy, and therefore transitions will occur for all those energy differences. Right? But how does this uncertainty in the energy arise? This arises if there is an uncertainty in time. So the time of measurement, time of all this cannot be determined simultaneously. That is the uncertainty principle. So how do we know if there is an uncertainty in the time? This we know because there is this finite lifetime for the excited state. And this happens because of the relaxation. You know that the thing which goes up comes down sometime. It doesn't stay there forever. There is always a possibility of its coming down. Therefore, there is a certain lifetime of the excited state. And because of that, there is an uncertainty in the time. And therefore, there is an uncertainty in energy. So we treat this uncertainty in time as a lifetime of the, so delta t you choose to be lifetime of the excited state. Now again, I have lost all the equations numbers. I will write once more some the current equation. This is 1.79. Okay. Now, what is it that causes the relaxation? Or what changes the lifetime of the excited state? There can be various reasons. Many factors play a role in dictating the lifetime of the excited state. The most common in spectroscopy, particularly so in optical spectroscopy, is what is called as spontaneous emission. Spontaneous emission is very powerful source of transition in optics. And that depends upon the interaction between the dipole moments and photon field, the radiation field. And here, that is extremely weak. So the first reason which we will say, various reasons, spontaneous emission this is an intrinsic line width. And this arises from interaction between radiation field and In NMR, this is extremely weak. I'll give you some number here. The transition probability caused by spontaneous emission in NMR is given by 2 to the power 2 by 3 gamma square h cross divided by lambda. So, and lambda is lambda by 2 pi. Lambda is the wavelength. Why is it extremely weak? This is because of lambda. What is the lambda in the case of RF? RF ideal, what is the wavelength in RF? Meter. Yeah, right. So it is actually quite long. So it's because of this very, very long wavelength that spontaneous emission in the case of NMR is extremely weak. And this approximate calculation shows is like of the order of 10 to the minus 25 seconds inverse. Okay, this is almost nothing. So practically you can see this doesn't contribute at all. Then we will have width due to spin lattice relaxation. So that's, this is the T1. So this I've already said, this happens because of the interaction between the lattice and your spin system. It always causes the transition. And therefore, excited state has finite lifetime, and this causes the relaxation. Spin-spin interactions in your spin system, if there are some spins, there are spin-spin interactions, it can cause small splittings. There can be many of such ones, and therefore there will be multiple transitions happening, and that will cause the line problem.
Sir, this spin lattice is also
like a spin system. Yes, it is, but those are coming from the lattice. So here you can have within the spin system, you can also have. Yeah, then you will have magnetic field inhomogeneity effects. So what does this mean? So if you have the B0 field, at a particular B0 field, of course, you will have a certain frequency. But if the field is not homogeneous, you have a sample, right? Only sample, only, so let's say take only water. You have water here, 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 everywhere. Only the water which is giving you one signal, right? One frequency of absorption. But if the field here is different from the field here, even though it may be very small, it will generate two frequencies. And then what we will get is the superposition of those two frequencies. There is one frequency here, another frequency there, and you may have a third frequency there, and a fourth frequency there. And the sum of all of these will give you a signal like this. And therefore, this is line broadening due to inhomogeneity. This has nothing to do with the intrinsic lifetimes, but it is an externally caused artifact. You can always improve this by shimming your magnet very well, so that you have, over the sample volume, you have the same homogeneous magnetic field. But those ones still lattice intrinsic factors, you will not be able to control. That is it. Then you also have electric waterfall effects. So the quadrupole moment arises, sudden nuclear higher quadrupole moment. And this is because if the nucleus is not spherically symmetric, it is an oval shape or something, then you will have the field gradients inside, electric field gradients inside. And this will also interact with your spin system, and that will change the lifetimes of the states, and this will also call land bonding. Often, whenever this is present, this will be very, very dominant relaxation mechanism. So lines will be extremely broad in such situations. The quadrupole is if you have a nucleus which is not symmetric, is not spherically symmetric. It is a shape, the egg shape, for example. Then you have a long axis and a small axis. So there is an anisotropy of field gradients along the two axes. And this causes a mechanism for relaxation. Inhomogeneity. Shimming meaning you adjust the magnetic field. So you have B0 field is inhomogeneous, let us say. So what one does is you have additional coils in your probe, okay, certain externally supplied additional coils. You put in some currents over there, they produce counter fields which will compensate for the inhomogeneities. There is inhomogeneity on the z-axis, or there can be inhomogeneity on the x-axis or the y-axis, and so on and so forth. And these are additional coils which are present in your shimming system, in your magnet. Okay? And they produce magnetic fields which tend to cancel these differences in this. So there are lots of them. There are something like about 28 of such coils in this spectrometer if you see. And there are some, earlier you used to have some 4, 5, 6. But these days, a lot of this are automatically built in, and shimming has also become very automatic. They actually map the magnetic field created by a B0, and initially they set it up so that all the shim coils adjust themselves. So there is auto shimming process. So you set it on auto shim, all these coils will adjust themselves to produce currents which compensate for this inhomogeneities in the field. Okay, now,
sir, what you told about is electric quadrupole effects?
Yeah. That is the quadrupole moment, it interacts with your magnetic spin system, and it changes the lifetimes of the states, lifetimes of the magnetic states. And because of it, it produces the relaxation mechanism. Okay, so we will not go into the mechanism how the electrical quadrupole moment interacts, and that of course is quite an elaborate theory that will be. We will not go into that. We will just take it that electrical quadrupole moment generates a field gradient which interacts with your magnetic spin system and changes the lifetimes of the states. Okay. Okay. So now, as a result of all of this, what we have to do is you incorporate this line width into your transition probability equation. You modify your transition probability equation to read like this, to say 1 by 4 gamma square h1 square g of nu. And this g of nu is the line shape function. So this will include the width. Okay, what the line shape function will be, we will see later. So you can modify your transition probability. So even if you are slightly off resonance, there will be some absorption of energy. Okay, and that happens because of this line width factor.
What is written G after?
G is a line shear function. G nu.